Amen. Thanks. Okay, so we have already as a church been studying out Genesis 1 and 2. We've already made our way through that. So if you're kind of tuning in and you're not in our church, we've been already studying this. And so we are quite familiar already with in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's a radical departure from what you will be fed in any secular institution. Now, the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. Ultimately, as God creates all of these things, God sees all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus, the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. We're going to talk about that vast array in this class right now. Part of this class is just simply to marvel at the expanse of God's brilliance and his creative capabilities. But we'll also zero in just a little bit in this class. This class has a real complement to the class that Travis is going to do, as Travis talks not only about origins and cosmology, and also about the fine-tuning of the universe. I'll touch on that a little bit, only because it makes what I'm about to share here all the more remarkable. And while Travis's argument would probably more technically be called the cosmological argument, my argument that I'll be talking about for God, the Creator, for Genesis 1 and 2, is technically called the teleological argument, coming from the Greek word teleos, meaning with purposefulness, that God created it with an end in mind, that he was going somewhere with all of this. It wasn't just a haphazard blind watchmaker who gets things going and just lets it go to see where it ends up, but that it was specifically and also wonderfully designed for you as his dear pinnacle of his creation. And so the title of this lesson is Priveleged Planet.
Come on, Ed.
And while we are a privileged planet, this is a view from the Voyager telescope sent back to us on February 14th of 1990. And as the Voyager 1 approached the very edge of the solar system, Earth now about 4 billion miles away, the Voyager 1 then turned, pointed back towards the sun, caught these rays coming across, and caught in the midst of one of those rays was what Carl Sagan would later famously call a pale blue dot, that being us. And that image was used with great effect to those that tried to make the claim that as far as we go, ain't nothing special about us. At best, we're a happy accident. There is no design, no special circumstances that attend to the creation of human life or the existence of the universe as we know it. In earliest of understandings of the universe, Aristotle and Ptolemy were the ones who postulated a geocentric model of the solar system. Geocentric just meaning the Earth is at the middle. The Earth stands still, and the rest of all things revolve around it. There are some people in this room who have a bit of a kind of a view that is somewhat like that, but has less to do with the Earth and is kind of more of a localized idea. Nonetheless, in 1543, Nicholas Copernicus, with a brainstorm and what is properly known as probably one of the great paradigm shifts of scientific revolution ever to occur, was able to think outside of the paradigm that was so prevailing that the Earth was at the middle of all things, and recognized that there must be something different. And in his book, The Revolution of Heavenly Spheres, he thought the impossible. The Earth moved. And in thinking that the Earth moved, he laid the cornerstone for all of modern astronomy, and also established what became known as, and became to be used as, and perhaps maybe even you heard it in school, the Copernican principle. And what is the Copernican principle? I basically have already stated it. There's nothing special about you. There's nothing special about us. The Earth occupies no preferred place in the heavens. It's also known as the principle of mediocrity. Yay! But it was also popularized by Carl Sagan in his famous, you know, 70s and 80s. Some of us cut our teeth on that when we were younger. The Cosmos show that he had. And there he said, hold on. There he said, look again at that dot. Our posturing, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have a privileged position in the universe are challenging this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. And that any self-importance on our part was merely posturing and our own imagination. But yet, the Bible affirms, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. Amen. Since what may be, and they have no speech, they use no words, no sound is heard from them, yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the end of the earth. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun. Now, it's also rather important because it has rather intense significance, the purposefulness and the orderliness and the wonder of creation. Because God also asserts, this is very important theologically in Romans 1, since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. In other words, those that have not personally heard special revelation of Scripture, they are not without excuse, because the heavens themselves declare so clearly and so strongly that there's got to be something behind all of this. Again, this is just simply Sagan's quote from his book, The Pale Blue Dot. Now, let's consider this dot. Let's consider the fact that no, we're not at the center of the solar system, nor are we at the center of the galaxy or at the center of the universe. We don't hold that particular place where all things revolve around us. Does that then, as much as that was a massive blow to the thinking of all that were trying to behold the heavens as the glory of God during the 1600s, does that in fact undermine the wonder of God's creative capacity to be able to set up everything, not only with fine-tuning, but also with purpose for us? And that's what I want to discuss today. But before we do that, let me just give us a bit of a kind of a lay of the land. And this stuff is so mind-blowing that it is beyond the human mind to really be able to appreciate.
Wow.
And if you want to kind of get a little bit of scale, when you get home, there's a really cool website, and it's called If the Moon Were the Size of One Pixel. Go look there. It's really interesting because it gives you a dimensional analysis of just our solar system, and it really is quite intense. But let's just say we took the size of planet Earth and we shrunk it down to the size of a tennis ball. And I will do some dimensional analysis based on this tennis ball. Now, by the way, if the Earth was shrunk down to the size of a tennis ball, and a tennis ball is rather fuzzy, and of course on Earth we have, you know, kind of really deep valleys in the midst of the Pacific Ocean, we have the soaring mountains in the Himalayas, we have what looks to be a rather uneven terrain. If any of you have tried to go biking in the Blue Ridge, you realize what a rugged terrain it is that we have. Some of you have gone downhill in that terrain in a way of folly. I'll also recognize that. I don't know why I keep pointing this way. But nonetheless, amen. If the Earth were brought down to the size of a tennis ball, it would be smoother than a cue ball. That's a little bit of dimensional analysis just from the surface. But however, we have a rather large moon. So the moon would be about the size of a marble. One-fourth the size, one-fourth the diameter of the Earth. Now, let's say we continue with this idea and try to figure out then, relatively speaking, how big would the sun be if we were the size of a tennis ball? Well, the sun would basically be the size of a three-story building.
Wow. Wow.
Oops. So there we are.
Oh, look, I have a pointer.
And there we have that. Now, that's a little bit of a kind of a help to see the difference between the two. But then how far away, if we're shrunk down to the size of a tennis ball, how far away are we? Is it like from here to the stage in the other room? Like, how far is that? Because it is 92 million miles. And it is, by the way, it does take 8 minutes and 20 seconds for that light, once it actually crests, you know, as the Earth rotates and it crests, for us to see. That happened 8 minutes earlier.
Wow.
That's how long that takes. It takes a second for us to see the light from the moon, but 8 minutes and 20 seconds to see it from the sun. So if we're shrunk all the way down to the size of a tennis ball, then the sun is essentially a half a mile away. It is 7 football fields away. That's the vastness of just our little corner of things, and even in this kind of unprivileged position, so to speak, where we are. Now, something happened in the 1920s. Between 1921 and 1926, this dimension of the universe began to really blow everyone's mind. Not just laymen, but astronomers as well. To the degree that it was too difficult, even for any human mind, to be able to begin to comprehend the vastness of the heavens, the vast array of the heavens, as Genesis 2 speaks of. And it was really being unveiled in the Mount Wilson Observatory in LA. The most powerful telescope that we had at the time was housed there, and it was during those years that Edwin Hubble made some of the most important discoveries in science. He determined, as he looked through his telescope all those years, that what he saw were not in fact stars, but galaxies. And it had transcended then the imagination of all that we had thought, many had thought, near to that point in time, that our solar system was the limit of the universe. That wasn't too many years earlier than this that was the case. And now it seems like the Copernican principle of the Earth and the life it sustains is really fading into insignificance in light of the vastness of the universe. As a matter of fact, the vastness of the universe begins to be so mind-blowing that if you kind of begin to even imagine the Milky Way, our one little galaxy with perhaps 300 billion stars in that one galaxy. And also to think that there are probably about 100 billion galaxies. Wow. It's pretty astounding. But let's just say, just a little bit of dimensional analysis in a different analogy now. Instead of using a tennis ball, I'm going to use a piece of paper. So that 92 million miles between you, Endicott, and the sun would be represented by this one sheet of paper. All right? If this represents 92 million miles from here to the sun, we reduced that distance. Speed of light traveling for 8 minutes and 20 seconds is represented by the thinness of this sheet of paper, right? Then the distance between the ends of our solar system, all end to end, which is much, much, much larger than we can begin to imagine, is about 100. Let's see if I'm getting to that right. Here we go. It's about this thickness, 100 sheets of this paper. So that's our universe end to end. Maybe once we discover this new planet, it might get a little bit bigger, so I add a couple sheets. But that's how wide end-to-end our solar system is. Now, if we were to go from Endicott to the next nearest star, how many sheets of paper would that be? Well, it would be these sheets of paper stacked 70 feet high. Again, each sheet is the speed of light for 8 minutes and 20 seconds, 92 million miles. That's just to the next star. This is the vastness of the array. And how about just this galaxy across? One of 100 billion galaxies. How big would that be? Well, if I took this sheet of paper and began to stack it, it would go as high as 310 miles. Right? That's what I'm saying. None of our brains even begin to try to hold on to this. Right, that's just one galaxy, and you even have a concept of 100 billion galaxies and the distance between them. So that's the vastness of the universe. And by the way, this is one of the famous shots enhanced of the Hubble telescope, where we began to realize that all these lights were not stars, these patches of light, but they were galaxies themselves. And you know what's interesting is that geologists have made an estimate of the number of sands of the seashore, and astronomers have made an estimate of the number of stars of the sky. And interestingly, they're about the same number. It's somewhere on the magnitude of about 100 billion times 100 billion or so. But they both come to that same number. Now, not that this is any sort of a scientific proof, but I think it's just interesting that when the great blessing in the book of Genesis occurs to Abraham, he says, "I will bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand of the seashore." When people originally read that, they thought, stars of the sky, that's a few hundred. But the sand of the seashore, who knows how many that could really be. But anyway, for us to, I think, have a proper awe, fear of the Lord, the vastness of his creation, Christ who holds all this together, even at this moment, to realize as you kind of, you just go to the beach, look at just all of the sands of the seashore, and then to imagine it all across all of the earth, all that sand that would occur. I mean, take that, and all of those are brilliance of stars with distances between them that are unfathomable, and then we're somehow just kind of falling short of even the slightest idea of how vast the array really is of the heavens that God has created. So, with all that in mind, the other thing that began to really become popular was the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, or a program that the government sponsored, SETI, S-E-T-I. And why that became so popular, it still is popular, and it is rather compelling, because even though the factors for life we understand are fine-tuned, and again, Travis will talk about that, even though those factors are fine-tuned, nonetheless, there's just so many chances, right? I mean, if there's that many possibilities of planets that could fall within the factors, certainly, as you know, I mean, Sagan thought that perhaps that there were billions, perhaps, of planets where there was life at the comparable level of intelligence as we have it. It was just a matter of time before we begin to intersect because of the distances that were between all of those. I don't want to talk about that, and I don't really, you know, think that that's actually a rather compelling idea. But I do want to talk about these factors that went into trying to figure out if there was extraterrestrial life, because those same factors then became very popular calculations to see how difficult it is to pull off life. And some of the big ones that really, I mean, the biggest one, first of all, is water. You need to have water for a lot of reasons. I'll talk about it in a minute. But it all begins with water. It has to be a terrestrial planet. I'm on the right side. Oxygen-rich atmosphere. You know that by the fact that you're breathing right now. Molten iron core for the magnetic field that it produces, a thin crust for tectonics, for the replenishment of the soil, so it doesn't just kind of all become a wasteland. On the bottom over here, a large moon to stabilize the tilt of our planet, for regulating temperatures and tides, the correct type of star, the age, the size, the temperature. We need to be protected by giant planets, or else correct distance from our star and a correct location in the galaxy itself. Now, all of these things, when you look at the chances of all of these things happening and what is the fine-tuning of each of these, never mind the fine-tuning of all the other factors just to bring universe and matter and energy and light all into existence and to keep it into balance, that fine-tuning is, I mean, just off the charts, unbelievable. But you might say, but you know what? Maybe it could be a possibility. And maybe it could happen again and again and again. Well, actually, the fine-tuning is so precise that it would be like you winning the $600 million lotto, Powerball lotto. Not just once, but every day from the beginning of the universe at the Big Bang 13.8 billion years ago. You winning it every single day from that day until this day. Then we come a little bit closer to how fine-tuned the universe really is.
Come on.
But you're saying there's a chance.
What do you think the chances are of a guy like you and a girl like me ending up together?
Well, Lloyd, that's difficult to say, and we really don't...
Hit me with it. Just give it to me straight. I came a long way just to see you married. Just, at least you can do is level with me. What are my chances?
Not good.
You mean not good like 1 out of 100?
I'd say more like 1 out of 1,000,000.
So you're telling me there's a chance?
Oh my God.
Yeah.
And
yeah, baby.
And as we continue to discover the physical laws that govern our universe, that were required for the Big Bang, that were required for the equilibrium of all matter and light, I'm telling you, it's not just a chance. Let me look at some of the factors. First, let's look at our atmosphere. This thin blue layer, it's less than 1% of our planet's diameter. This fragile, fragile atmosphere that is ours. And one of the great necessities for life is an oxygen-nitrogen atmosphere. It ensures a temperate climate, protection from the sun's radiation, combo of gases for liquid water, and for complex life. And the Earth's mass is just enough to keep this thin layer of gases above us. Slightly more gravity, slightly more mass of the Earth means a heavier, more destructive atmosphere with too much ammonia and too much methane. Less mass, less gravity, and too much water than is lost into the greater space. Our atmosphere is 20% oxygen. Any less, complex life slows. None, no life. Any more, everything burns a lot faster and our bodies age much, much quicker. The thin, invisible ozone layer keeps us alive by absorbing the destructive radiation from space. Less ozone, we roast in ultraviolet light from the sun. Any more, we don't get enough of the sun's life-giving energy to the surface, and plant growth is stalled. Carbon dioxide acts like a blanket and keeps us warm. Any less, we freeze and plants die out. Okay, there's a Toyota Highlander VRN7696 that is blocking another car that needs to be able to go somewhere. Toyota Highlander VRN7696. Fair enough. Gray, silver colored Toyota Highlander. Okay, but this carbon dioxide level, if we have any less of this, which is this insulating factor, any less, we freeze and plants die out. Any more, we fry with runaway greenhouse effect. Water vapor, again, I'm gonna zip through these. I bet Travis has some of these as well. Give me the, like, if I'm doing your stuff. The moon has also had an amazing effect, and it is such a critical thing to have a large moon, 1/4 the size of the Earth. Also, the moon locks us into an axis tilt that gives us a 23.44 degree tilt that allows us to be able to have seasonal temperate conditions. It also keeps us at a 24-hour rotation, which keeps our temperatures nice and our winds under control. Perfect, as a matter of fact. Even our hurricane force, compared to anywhere else that you could imagine, that you could measure, is incredibly low. Any faster of a rotation, winds get unbearable. Any slower, and the temperature difference becomes unbearable. Also, as we rotate, inside we have a core, a magnetic, because of a molten iron core. And in this magnetic field, if our planet had a smaller field, it would be weaker and it would allow solar winds to strip away our atmosphere, and we end up like Mars.
Wow.
And it protects us from these deadly winds and gives us... Now, every now and again, you do see the effects of radiation coming in, and that's what we call the aurora borealis, or the northern lights. So we see it from time to time, but we realize how rare that really is. Now, here's something that's really interesting, is that our sun is the perfect spectral type G2 dwarf main sequence star. Wow. Just the right age, just the right size. If it were less massive, like 90% of all the other stars, the Earth would have to be a lot closer to get the warmth. But if we were closer, you know what would happen? We'd get locked into a synchronous orbit where one side of the Earth would always be facing the sun. One side would always be blazing hot. The other side would always be dark. One side, ice and cold, extreme conditions on both sides, no Earth. The age, the mass, the brightness, the generation, everything about our sun happens to be just perfectly tuned for us. And maybe it's an amazing list of complex coincidences, but it is also amazing that the sun has increased over the 4 billion years of our solar system. The sun has increased in luminosity at just the same rate as the greenhouse gases were also developing on the Earth from our atmosphere, so that the whole time the Earth could maintain a life-friendly constant temperature for 4 billion years.
Nice.
Astounding. Yeah. Now, it's not just needing to be in the habitable zone, right? Not too far, not too distant. If we were just 5% closer, we would fall into a fate of all the closer planets without life. If we were somewhere around 50% further away, that's how narrow this band is, then likewise we would end up looking like Mars as a planet. But that's not the only habitable zone that is important. The other big habitable zone that is important is in the galaxy itself. Too close to the center of a galaxy and you've got a black hole. And a black hole rips things apart, or you get sucked into it. Not a good day. And also, the closer you are to the center of a galaxy, the more cosmic dust there is, the more stars there are, more dense it is, and that also causes a lot of trouble. I'll talk about in a minute. But if you're too far out to the edge, then what happens if you're too far out to the edge is that you would then not have enough of the kind of heavier materials for planet building. Those would be like magnesium and iron that are so important in planet building. And again, too far out to the edge, and you wouldn't have a planet of sufficient size. Overall, these are all the factors that go into having a hyper-fine-tuned habitat for life. But we are obviously fine-tuned, a habitable planet, astoundingly so. But does that provide enough proof? Just the fact that it is so fine-tuned, is that enough proof for us to say, well, obviously, you know, you're not going to win the lotto every single day for 13.8 billion years. So obviously, there is an anthropic principle that could poke holes even in the rare chance of the fine-tuning. So as wonderful as that is, that's not even the greatness of it.
Tell us. Wow.
The craziness of all of this is the stuff that we should just fall on our knees and be amazed at God. So, first of all, I've already mentioned the importance of our moon, and on October 24th of 1995, in northern India, there was a total eclipse of the sun. Astronomers from all over the Earth converged for that observation, and for 51 seconds, they all looked on in wonder. It was a mysterious beauty, and the amazing factors that made it all possible were not lost on the people that gathered there that day. And from that gathering was also the recognition that going back through the 19th century, especially the 1870 eclipse, helped us to realize that the 1870 eclipse was the beginning of us practicing what is using spectroscopy to see the specific outer ring, the kind of the atmosphere, the chromosphere of the sun, and to be able to recognize that what were the elements that began to make our sun? And then later, by extension, as we applied the same principles to other planets, what were the elements that were the building blocks of the entire universe? That's unbelievable discovery. We little, you know, folks that we are suddenly being able to determine with certainty things like the elements that are created all throughout the vastness array of the heavens. But in order for that to happen, we needed to have a perfect eclipse. Perfect eclipse. Very little room for error for this, in order for God to show off and allow us as his superintendents of creation. We who would not only watch and keep and serve, but subdue creation as he extends it on us to us. Here's the amazing part about this, is as fine-tuned as our moon is to keep us in synchronous orbit, to keep our tides flowing, to keep the waters fresh, to do all of those things, to keep our temperatures right, and our sun, all of the perfectness of the Goldilocks zone in which we find ourselves. On top of all of that, when the sun and the moon align themselves to our privileged perch, it happens to be that our sun in appearance is 400 times, I'm sorry, our sun in appearance is exactly the same size as the moon. They both are, if you look at like the arc of the sky, they're both a half a degree. But the sun is not the same size as the moon. It's 400 times bigger in diameter than our moon. But it is also exactly that same far distance away, 400 times further away than our moon.
That's crazy.
And again, we need to be just the right distance from that sun, and we need to be just the right distance from that moon. There are only about 65 places in all of the solar system that we know of where you can kind of be able to observe the sun. Right, 65 bodies, maybe 70, depending on where they are. And so, and that's the planets, the different moons, Io and Titan, all of those moons, right? And of all of those, the only place where you have a solar eclipse that allows you to see the chromosphere is on Earth.
Wow.
It's the only place where that can be. And it was a giant natural experiment to observe a part of the sun in order to measure the upper layer of the sun's atmosphere, which would otherwise be impossible to experience. This flash spectrum appears when viewed through a prism. And as I said, in 1870, this chromosphere became visible, and it led to an understanding of helium. And then they got to be able to figure out the spectrum of the sun and how it's produced. And also, the moon, if it were any smaller or any further, would allow too much of the rays of the sun to come through during an eclipse and obscure any spectroscopy. Any larger, and it would block too much of the chromosphere. And again, we wouldn't get a full spectrum as we tried to use spectrum analysis. And we would never learn about the elements of the universe itself. But that's not all. During this time, during the late 1870s and into the early 1900s, and into 1920, we were able to observe during this time light moving around the moon from the sun to the Earth, and we were able to then perform one other great experiment to see whether Einstein's theory of relativity held or not. And we were able to determine with certainty, because of this privileged perch, because of the sun and the moon, that his theory of relativity was in fact valid. E equals mc squared, that indeed gravity does have an effect on energy and light, that it does bend, and all of that then allowed for the theory of relativity to then open our minds with certainty to be able to understand the brilliance and the elegance of God's creation. The factors for complex life and for scientific observation by complex life come together in the same place. The best place for making scientific observations and discoveries in all of our solar system is also in the only place where it is habitable for intelligent life. In the book, The Priveleged Planet, they say the same narrow circumstances that allow us to exist also provide us with the best overall setting for making scientific discoveries. Now, one other thing is our atmosphere. I've already talked about it. Thin layer, certain mix, it supports a complex biosphere. There are 70 planets and moons, only 7 have an atmosphere in all of our solar system. And I get it. It's only one sun, one solar system. And the only the Earth's atmosphere, out of the seven that have an atmosphere, has the mixture of elements to be able to sustain complex life. No other body in our solar system has the mix of, you know, I've already mentioned nitrogen, carbon dioxide a little bit, and oxygen, nitrogen, and carbon dioxide. But only the Earth's atmosphere not only can sustain life, but of all the atmospheres that I just mentioned, there's only one that's transparent, and that's ours.
Wow.
And if not, then that Mount Wilson Observatory would be an anomaly, and it would be no reason for it, and no chance for us to be able to better understand the brilliance of God. It's as though God said to us, not only am I taking care of you with fine-tuning, but I'm also setting you up to check me out.
Right.
And to know that the heavens do indeed declare the brilliance of God. We have very little carbon compounds, so there's no haze like on the Titan moon. None of those places can even see the sun, much less stars. The atmosphere is bombarded by radiation from the sun and other supernovas far, far away. There's a tremendous amount of electromagnetic spectrum. That's all wavelengths, right? And in this band of all, I'm talking about X-rays, gamma rays, you pick all of that wavelength, there is only a sliver. It's one trillionth of the entire spectrum is what comes through into our atmosphere, and we know that is visible light. And that's what our atmosphere allows in, and it's also the only portion of that spectrum that is useful for complex life, for photosynthesis, for the other things that we've already mentioned a little bit here. It's the type of light that our sun produces, and our atmosphere allows it to penetrate our planet. Why the most habitable are also the best places for scientific observations and discovery? Why? Because God took great care as he designed all of this. That's not all. I'm going to do one more of these.
Come on, Ed.
This one is astounding, and it's our position in the Milky Way galaxy. As I've already mentioned, our galaxy is a spiral galaxy. It's flattened. It's got a bulge in the middle, and we're about halfway to two-thirds of the way out towards the edge, which is the only habitable zone. Again, middle, black hole, bad, outer, to not dense enough with heavy metals. Good to have heavy metal. So we're in just the right place. It is the galactic habitable zone, and it is our neighborhood of the galaxy. But even within this habitable zone, it would still be very dangerous if we landed on one of the arms of the spiral. So even though you could be in the right spot, if you're in an arm, that could be because there are a lot of supernova, there's a lot of collisions, there's a lot of gravity issues with so many. But we are in this unbelievable place, and we're safely tucked between the Sagittarian arm and the Perseus arm of the Milky Way. Location, location, location. Habitability is maximized, threats are minimized, and there's enough material to build planets. We're also, get this, in the very best setting that we could possibly be able to look at the structure of our own Milky Way and to peer out from our Milky Way to look as far as the creation horizon event itself. And because of that, Hubble, through his telescope, not the Hubble telescope that is flying through space, but through the Mount Wilson Observatory, was able to observe, as he saw the galaxies and the planets, the redshift phenomenon, which led to the mind-blowing scientific discovery that all objects are moving away and are accelerating away from one another, which then affirmed all of not only Einstein's theory, with his fudge factor kind of taken back in, but all of his theory, to recognize that all of creation started at an infinitesimally small singularity. So much so that all of the equations, not all of the equations, but the vast majority of the equations Point to a time as you kind of interpolate backwards or extrapolate backwards from what it is that we observe from that red shift. The red shift means that things are having a Doppler effect of sorts, not a kind of traditional Doppler effect that we think of with sound, but a bit different with light as they all extend far from us. And that as you bring that back to where they would have come from, that it would have been at a point before space, before time, before matter. It is a mind-blowing idea that all of that could be. And how could we actually come to the conclusion that there was a beginning and that in the beginning there was something other than time itself and matter itself? Because God said, not only am I going to make all of this just perfect for you to be able to live and move and have your being, but I am also going to give you a perch from which you can peer out and be amazed at the heavens themselves, at the elegance of it all. As a matter of fact, the more that we learn, the more elegant the equations come, the more jaw-dropping the observations are, the more wondrous every discovery is. We have a very low dust area, very clear view of the heavens. We can study this. Dust clouds are often illuminated by stars around them. We have none of that. We are in the best place for habitability and the best place for observation itself. We can understand the universe in all of its exquisite detail because it is accessible to our minds. Minds that were made by God. Minds made in the image of God. And as a result, we've discovered many other factors that I think Travis will spend time on some of those. Many other factors that also blow our minds about how fine-tuned the universe has to be. Even for the Big Bang to have existed, the fine-tuning of those factors for the Big Bang to have occurred, for there to be a beginning, and for that to be beginning to be as we understand it, all of that is now being understood better and better every day, and all it does is point to the fact that none of this could be by chance. And so it's no wonder that as Einstein continued to have his equations affirmed, that he says, I have deep faith that the principles of the universe will be both beautiful and simple. Now, I pray this for my kids as they go to school, as they're studying out astronomy or physics or biology. And I pray every day that they would understand the wonders of God. Amen. And not allow it to be in any way denigrated by others who would somehow try to make it without meaning, without purpose, without significance. We are all of those things. And because of those things, we are understanding the vast array of his heavens. And to conclude with Copernicus again, the reason that he began to look for what he looked for is he looked at the models that were so convoluted of trying to make sense of how it was that the planets were somehow moving around Earth. Again, think about how they all move. It's such a beautiful model now that we understand it, right? Yeah. Sun in the middle, we're all moving around. Try to make sense of that model. You can see some of those old models, and they're mechanical, and they are really convoluted. Copernicus had a deep-seated idea of the brilliance of God, that it must be something more simple than that. And so that's why he said, I sought the mechanism of the universe wrought for us by a supremely good and orderly creator. And in conclusion, Colossians 1:15-17 says, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. When you hear all things, it ought to cause you to really tremble at what that includes and to realize the beautiful balance and the elegance of the equations that describe it, as well as the privilege given to us to be able to go ahead and discover it as those made in the image of God. Amen. Wow. Thanks.